Okay, boys and girls, today we are talking about 7 survival traps to avoid. Let's jump right into this. As always, please don't forget to comment, like, share, and subscribe. So let's jump right into it. Okay, so the first trap to avoid is going to be survival cards or any kind of hidden survival equipment. Things such as, you know, survival things that are in belts and hats and so many pieces of clothing. The primary reason why you want to avoid this kind of stuff is survival cards, survival clothing is really oriented towards the false sense of security that, you know, oh, I'm prepared for anything. You know, I have my fire cord, I have my fire starter, I have traps or little jigs. And while some of this stuff is more useful than others, by and large, most of it is pretty useless, especially if you really need to survive. If you are in a cold environment like, say, Alaska, and you need to get firewood, you need to build a shelter, a lot of this type of survival card stuff just is not going to cut it. It's not going to be durable enough. What you really need is real survival tools, like full-blown survival knives. You need stuff that is real, that is a thick, you know, handle that you can beat on, you know, that you can actually collect firewood with, not something that gives you the false sense of security. So survival cards and any type of survival clothing or, you know, equipment in that regard is just a no. The only type of kind of survival equipment, if you will, that I personally like are just plain Jane paracord bracelets. And paracord bracelets that are oriented towards having a large amount of paracord in them for using it as cordage for survival. So that's number one. So the next one is going to be fake survival knives. Now, I don't have any good examples here, primarily because I don't really own any and I don't really carry any, obviously. But fake survival knives are essentially just knives that are usually low-end, usually made by specific companies, such as maybe Gerber. And not to say that all of Gerber's knives are terrible, but they, especially back in the early 2010s, had a way of, you know, marketing survival knives that just were not to par. Once again, you could not utilize them in actual survival manners, doing things that you would need to do in a real survival situation, such as batoning wood or hard use things. So fake survival knives are just essentially knives that are pushed out on the public, and they're not really built to high quality, and heck, they may not even have the input of real survivalists, people who actually go outdoors and practice. So you want to avoid those traps as well. The next one for me is survivalist signature series. And what I mean by this is we've probably all seen it, whether it's someone that's gone out alone or has their own survival show or whatever, you know, you'll see people come out with signature survival equipment and stuff that, you know, has their name on it, maybe their brand on it. And overall, this type of stuff, you know, even if it's good equipment, usually signature survival kind of stuff tends to be extra expensive just because you're paying for that person's name. So once again, not all of this equipment is just rubbish per se, but some of it is. But even the stuff that isn't bad, you're going to be paying more than you would be if you just found a similar type of item without the name attributed to it. So a trap that I try to recommend people avoid is, you know, going after things that, you know, have a certain survivalist name or are made by a certain person, or rather made by a company for a certain survivalist or bushcrafter or YouTuber. You know, like I said, there are some good tools, don't get me wrong, and there are some good pieces of equipment. But usually, even with those better pieces of equipment, you're paying extra just for the name's sake. So it's kind of pointless and something that I try to recommend people avoid altogether. So the next survival trap for me is what I kind of call DIYs, or do-it-yourselves. And so there are quite a few things out there on the survival market, and for this one in specific, I'm talking about survival kits. And you can go out and you can buy many different types of survival kits, and there are some survival kits that are better than others, but really when it comes down to it, there are certain things that if you really take survival or preparedness for survival seriously, you have to do it yourself. And so something like my personal survival kit here is very well tailored to me. And moreover, you know, you really can't go out and buy, you know, this type of kit, or if you did, it would be extremely expensive. I mean, everything here I've collected throughout you know, the course of several years. But altogether, you know, there's probably close to $600 worth of stuff put into this. Now, granted, that does also factor that, you know, this PLB here is about $300. But, you know, overall, this is a very expensive kit. And so if you were to try to go to someone who is pre-making a similar kit to my PSK, you know, it would probably be $600-$700 to buy, you know, the same exact kit from someone else. So ultimately, you know, you have to really build it yourself, you know, really do it yourself. And not only is that better for price efficiency, but you know what you're getting. And moreover, when you build your own kit, it teaches you, you know, what pieces you have, why you have it, why you need it, and you practice with it. You know, you kind of grow with your survival kit. So stuff like survival kits, and there are other things that I heavily recommend that you just have to do it yourself. No pre-made, pre-bought type of survival kit or equipment is going to be as good as something that you can manufacture yourself. Obviously, you know your needs better than anyone else, and you know what you need in your kit. And once again, these kits tend to be expensive, so taking the time, you know, to buy everything, to acquire everything over the course of several years as opposed to in that moment might be what it ends up coming down to. So the next one for me is going to be survival bows and survival slingshots. Now, not all survival bows and slingshots are bad. Most of them are serviceable, but I usually discourage people from going with these types of equipment because they're usually takedown types of bows or slingshots or even rifles. And whenever you have takedown equipment, especially bows, they tend to be weaker or they tend to be harder to use. So I always try to recommend, if you are going to be running a type of hunting method, whether that be a slingshot or a bow or a rifle, you know, try to take the most pure form of that thing or of that piece of equipment, because it's going to work the best for you. It's going to have the best ergonomics. It's going to have the least amount of weaknesses, and it's going to overall serve you pretty darn well. So that's why you see me running for my bows. They're all just traditional standard recurve bows. I'm not running any takedowns or any type of fancy bows in particular, just because the solid standard recurves are going to be the most durable, the most user-friendly, and the most realistic in a real situation for hunting. Okay, so similar to survival cards, the next one is micro survival gear. Now, there's a lot of push to running smaller and smaller pieces of kit, and maybe for everyday carry, you know, running some micro gear might not be bad, but small pieces of equipment usually are not the best. And what I mean by this is, though I don't necessarily mean to, you know, hate on any pieces or any knives per se, but things like this Essie Azula, you know, a lot of people will say, you know, this is my survival knife. But realistically, if you really need a good solid survival knife, you should be looking at something a little bit larger, a little bit more capable of doing general camp tasks. You know, this Essie Azula will be better at processing game animals than the Buck Thug here, but at the same time, you know, processing food is important in survival, but building a shelter, building fire, using a fire to signal for rescue is going to be much more important than being able to process game. So going with a larger knife or a larger tool, you know, even a hatchet or a saw, is going to be much more beneficial than micro gear for survival kits and survival situations. And another kind of example of this is a lot of people build survival kits and then they'll put, you know, a really small, really tiny, even smaller than this Essie Azula, you know, fixed blade in their survival kit. They'll be like, okay, it's a fixed blade, it's strong, it's robust. But I would personally recommend, if you must go that route, you know, throw a Benchmade 556 mini grip or a bug out in there, because for the same size as that fixed blade, you can throw in a folder and that folder doubles in size. So you have a realistic handle to hold on to, a realistic blade to do whatever you need to do with. So either way, you know, a very small blade isn't going to do a whole lot as far as, you know, robust tasks, but you want to give yourself the best option you can. So the last one kind of parallels the, you know, don't buy survival equipment, you know, like hats or belts or any of that stuff with survival features packed in. But this is ultimately, don't subscribe to survival lifestyle brands. I think that there are brands, and I'm not going to name any here because I don't want to bash anyone specifically, but there are brands out there that try to promote survival as an everyday kind of lifestyle, something that, you know, you should always be prepared for any type of situation. And the reality is, you know, you want to be in, especially if you, you know, like to carry a lot of things like knives, flashlights and stuff, you should be prepared for a lot of situations on a daily basis. But being prepared for a survival situation every single time you leave your house might not be the most necessary thing. Now, of course, depending where you live, it may be more realistic than not, but for most people that live in urban environments, you know, I think a lot of these brands try to target these people that live in urban environments. And the fact of the matter is, you probably won't need to start a fire. You probably won't need to, you know, saw your way out of something. You know, including all of these survival pieces of kit on your body every day is something that you can do if you would like, but I think it's a way for companies to try to take more money from you and to try to just give you gear that realistically you just don't need, and to foster a sense of insecurity within you, because you always have to be prepared. You always have to be on edge, because anything can happen at any moment. And like I said, if you spend a lot of time in the wilderness, this equipment might be more tenable or more realistic for you. So maybe someone like myself would find more use in it. But a lot of people that live in urban environments, I still think it's important for them to know survival skills, but you don't need to subscribe to survival lifestyle types of brands. You know, your hat doesn't need to have 14 functions. Your belt doesn't need to have 30 hidden items. Your shoelaces don't need to have, you know, 2 or 5 or 10 functions to them. Just get good quality gear, get a good belt, get a good hat, get a good pair of boots, and just live with them. You don't need to focus on survival constantly. And once again, you know, if you're someone like me who practices survival a lot, maybe you should lean more towards survival lifestyle. It tends to be something that, you know, I tend to live in the woods a lot. But realistically, most people are not spending as much time in the wilderness as myself, so you don't need to focus on these things. Don't spend your money in that regard. You know, save up, get good quality pieces of kit. You know, go for, you know, good solid knives instead of buying, you know, like a $70 survival belt. You know, buy a $50 belt, save the $20 in unnecessary survival equipment, and maybe take that $20 and put it into a real PSK that you can carry on your belt that will have more functionality and better ability anyways. So that's kind of my spiel about lifestyle brands. I just see more of them popping up, or, you know, I see Kickstarters trying to push, you know, like this newest way to include survival, and, you know, they have like a 14 function, you know, survival hatchet. It's like, no, just grab a normal hatchet for the same price. You don't need mass functionality in every piece of kit. You know, having a knife that is just a knife is okay. You know, having a hatchet that is just a hatchet, or a saw that's just a saw, is okay. You don't need to have multifunction everything. Not everything has to be super survival-y. And so I think in that regard, that's kind of my spiel about survival lifestyles. And I think it's a trap and a kind of up-and-coming thing to just avoid. So anyways, guys, hopefully you've enjoyed this video. As always, God bless, and I'm out.